Okay, hello and greetings everyone. Thank you for joining us for another session today here on TOMTEC Academy. My name is Doug Bito. I am the Clinical Marketing Manager with TOMTEC Imaging. Today's two-part webinar series will focus on 3D echocardiography and heart failure assessment and treatment. And joining us today is Rick Meece. Rick is an advanced cardiac imaging specialist associated with St. Thomas Heart, based in Nashville, Tennessee. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mr. Meece as our guest speaker, and of course, thank you everyone for joining us.
Thank you, Doug. So hello everyone, and good day, and all those good things. And I just want to spend a few minutes talking about some of our experience working with 3D echocardiography, and more on the assessment end. I think the treatment part, I'm going to go over some of those points, but obviously that kind of extends into the physician cardiologist end of the decision making. But I do work very closely with our heart failure team and all the things that those patients receive as a result of that care. So let me get on the right screen. There we go. So I do some research and study development. I do a lot of the CTR imaging for the surgical mitral valves, robotics, transcatheter procedures, and a lot of clinical echo, of course, too. And I've done a lot of work in also strain mechanics, and we will cover that some today. Just so you know a little bit about us, depending on where you're from, we're, again, in Nashville, Tennessee. We are a center of excellence in most of the advanced cardiac care algorithms, roughly average size or maybe larger size tertiary community hospital, and we are the flagship of a number of hospitals we have here in the region. So today, some of the objectives that I want to cover quickly are basically what's the heart failure perspective in terms of the treatment from the physicians and what they want to know for why we would be using 3D volumes, where we used to use MUGA scan, and we still, of course, use MRI and for these things as well. We'll look at some about the methods and the operator variability issues that the 3D addresses, the technical aspects of just using 3D volumetrics. We will talk a bit about 3D strain because that's really actually been available, but it's becoming more and more in vogue, and I think that's going to increase. We'll look at some case studies, and then we'll look a little bit at the LVA program, TOMTEC's program, and basically show you how I address certain things on a couple of difficult data sets, one being technically average and another being a TEE data set in an ischemic heart. So in advanced heart failure, as most of us know, we're dealing basically with some type of cardiomyopathy, whether it's an idiopathic, it's from chemotoxicosis or alcoholism for that matter, ischemic disease, or just hypertrophic failure. And of course, we all know sometimes there's infiltrative issues in terms of amyloidosis and all those things. Then also the other back end of it, particularly important for 3D, is valvular disease, because the regurgitation, of course, affects the ventricle, the papillary distance, increases the MR. So all of these loading conditions really can be roughly evaluated in traditional means, but much better by 3D. Pulmonary disease, of course, affects any type of heart failure symptoms, as well as over half of us that have heart failure actually have preceding diastolic heart failure or primary diastolic heart failure. The symptomology of HF is not really driven as much by the EF as much as it is what the derivative of the EF is doing for the body. The symptomology is usually driven really more by resistance in the lung from perhaps MR or something like that, and the forward stroke volume. So if they can give medicines that help control the pulmonary pressure resistance and then also improve, you know, contractility with inotropes or just remodeling the heart with diuretics and ARBs and those kind of things, then they're going to improve how the patient feels. And we're obviously here to make the patient feel better. We all are very good at eyeballing LVEF. I've done numerous kind of fun class things. And honestly, if that's all we had to know, I think EF, we would do a very good job visually and qualitatively. I think most people with experience are actually pretty good at that. But that's just not the derivative that we really need, which is what we're going to talk about. LV remodeling is generally most accurately tracked, particularly for the heart failure specialist, with end-diastolic volume and end-systolic volume index based on the patient's body size. And this is in particular in serial studies where you have different types of pathologies that are affecting that remodeling of the heart, whether through, you know, volume overload or even underfilling, and on the pressure and resistance on both sides of that. So 3D volumes by MRI or 3D echo are much more specifically accurate. And more importantly, as we move more and more into a world of national and international registry databases, it meets the more objective method requirements, and they are requirements technically, for HF management, decision-making, devices for candidacy for a lot of our patients' research studies, and then, of course, just making decision on surgical interventional purposes, which would include the right ventricle, because the right ventricle can be one of the more worrisome parts of coming on and off pump for certain types of procedures. So it's a complex cascade of some type of insult to the myocardium. Then you get the myocardial dysfunction. You get resistant system perfusion and oxygen transport. And then you start doing problems I've even had myself in the past with sympathetic activation. And you got your, you know, renin-aldosterone. You got all these different drugs, spironolactones, and these drugs that try to inhibit these things and help that problem. And a lot of it comes down to it starts altering the gene expression, and at the end of the day, the LV starts remodeling. And so how do we look at that? Well, we basically look at it in remodeling as a structural or a geometric term. It's not really a functional term. So what you're really talking about is how big is the preload, or how much is the preload, how big is the ventricle, how small is the ventricle in systole, and then how spherical or rounded is the ventricle, which affects a lot of other outcomes. And it goes on and on and on. And just some numbers on it. It's pretty easy to know that most of these people, as they dilate, they kind of tend to rip up their fascicles and their bundles, and so they get bundle branch block, depending on which fascicle is blocked, whether it's complete or partial. And we know from CRT studies, which we'll talk a little bit about, that as the bundle gets wider and the QRS becomes wider, the morbidity and mortality becomes much, much worse in terms of long-term survivability. So in the VET study, QR duration was found to be an absolutely independent predictor of mortality, and that's what got us into the age of ICDs and cardiac resynchronization therapy. In terms of severity, you can see the differences between the heart failure classes, that the morbidity and sudden death just really climbs, and the CHS symptoms go way, way up as you get into class four, where basically they're having a very difficult time functioning just even normally around the home and going to the mall. They're just very short of breath. So the predictive value of the volumes for us as clinicians, whether you're a physician, echocardiographer, and these days with anesthesia being much more involved with point of care, emergency room physicians, point of care, that's a very rapidly growing area right now, is the clinical and decisions made on the diastolic function and then the volume loading conditions. And a lot of times these are just immediate decisions on whether to diurese or fill up a patient or, you know, whatever needs to be done. And so their pharmacological management is affected. And then, of course, if it's just isolated to that, they may get a CRT or an ICD. Then we can help also manage the coronary disease. They've had a stent put in, then we want to look at what improvement we have in contractility or changes in function. And then, of course, as we well know, we have people that get cardiotoxicity, and, you know, chemotherapeutic agents can give them a myopathy. And most people nowadays have read enough to know that we would do a baseline 3D echo with 2D global longitudinal strain and 3D strain, so we have a baseline to go by and make sure that strain value and the size of the heart does not change as the patient's receiving those therapies. And then it's very helpful for the progression of valvular disorders, in particular mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, and aortic stenosis. This is from the 2015 ESC guidelines, just not out too long ago. This is just some of our more traditional ways of looking at the ventricle in terms of dimensions. You can look at it this way. This is just showing, you know, how to line it up properly in the long axis view across the mitral tips. And then we have the biplane method. And here they discuss using contrast, which everyone should be using very freely these days as they need to if they don't have the images they need. And then what we'll talk about today was 3D, and also touch on some global longitudinal strain as well. Also looking at the guidelines, where they did look at different ethnicities across the world in terms of average BSA of different peoples, and then we have some numbers from these guidelines. And For those that are not members or don't know this, and probably do on this call, this is freely available on the ASE site. You do not have to be a member to get guidelines. So you will be able to get a copy of this video, I believe, view it online, and you can get this, type this address in, go under guidelines and pick up any of these guidelines that give you some of the normal cutoff values and the new diastolic guidelines as well. So basically, having said all that and having read the guidelines, the current minimum standard for our center, and I think just about any center that's really serious about doing really good work, and I'm talking about system-wide, not just at one main tertiary hospital, is at least biplane volumes. And it's a very good technique, and in terms of EF and getting an overall sense of volumes, it's a very robust technique. But there's been some good work done, and you've heard about this, that there are a lot of assumptions we make in 2D, and what I see personally clinically is that we, even between sonographers, people tend to get a different angle, a little different spot, you know, on the rib cage, whether they turn them the same. Maybe the patients are in a little different condition than they were on the last echo. And between sonographers, we tend to have some subjectivity. So sometimes clinical patients have different sonographers on different visits, and that definitely affects the 2B imaging positioning, and that can affect their analysis and how they analyze the where to put the templates. So basically, 3D overcomes all of these things, and we're going to demonstrate that. This is a slide I made really for a research study for a sponsor, but really it's important to really realize that we have really very little subjectivity when it comes to between vendor carts in terms of the transducer architecture. There's minor differences. There may be differences in the way the cart is set for presets, but most experienced sonographers basically make their own presets anyway. I do think the scanning experience is important, but you know, I have people that have come straight out of Mayo's program, Mayo Clinic, and, you know, they come out and they scan very well. So it really just comes down to their experience and how adept they are. Then it becomes a little more subjective when you talk about how well are you training the sonographers to do the same things, how compliant are they to the echo protocols, because people sometimes don't do all the things they should. And then the subjectivity gets much higher when you talk about the actual patient and what they're able to tolerate and their body habits. So Dr. Chukwu et al. And my friend Dr. Gopal did a really good paper a few years ago talking about this. I highly recommend you look this paper up and you can go over the data. But they really found that most of the problems with 2D imaging compared to 3D were, as I said, the image positioning, taking the geometric assumptions of biplane, particularly in ischemic patients that have aneurysmal segments, and then how is the boundary tracing really being done. And within that paper, you can see there's just a tremendous amount of bias here with agreement in 2D as compared to going to multiplane out to 3D. I mean, here the bias is 1, this is a 38, and our variability here is 5.2, 7.3. So it's just much, much more robust than biplane even. And so basically they found that the image positioning error was the dominant problem in 2D biplane, where geometrical error was a little bit less, but mostly, as we mentioned, with patients with MIs because they have an aneurysm that we don't see in the four-chamber, two-chamber, three-chamber, and that doesn't get into the quotient of the volume changes, and thereby we lose accuracy. So there's no doubt that ischemic MR is the real needy, you know, element for 3D echo. And there's been studies, Jenkins et al. Looked at the inter and observer variability. And again, without looking at the charts, we know there's a fair amount of variability between 2D and 3D, and because of the planar alignment, 3D really overcomes that, and we'll demonstrate that at the end of this particular section. Again, this is just your charts just showing that looking at an MRI comparative using 3D versus 2D, your 2D plot graph here is a much, much wider width of agreement and disagreement, where 3D is very, very tight. So it's just, this is out of 50 patients. So it's very obvious. We do have some questions about 3D reproducibility, and there was a good issue written on this by the Chicago team. And they were talking in terms of 3D speckle tracking, but the speckle tracking is the method that's used mathematically for the automatic tracing. And of course, then we can edit those traces. But basically they found that some of the parameters are vendor dependent, which we know, and that's something we had a concern about, and also that the inter-vendor discordance has to be taken into account. So we'll talk about that. The way we looked at decreasing analysis subjectivity, a center to center, operator to operator, and within ourselves, was either to make an effort to use an identical cart or vendor independent software for the analysis. We actually have both. Then that gets more continuity. So basically we have mostly one brand of cart here, and then we have their version of the 3D volumetrics on the cart, and then we have the TOMTEC LVA on our workstation. So I have a choice, and we have a choice to use one or the other. And you know, I won't go into the preferences of why we would use one over the other in certain instances, but I do tend to use the LVA because I do a lot more work that's more specific to certain types of decision making, where maybe the average 3D echo and let's say the outpatient level, they're basically just trying to follow serial echoes, and it may be more productive for them to do that software on the cart. So both systems work really well. And the next thing is to use proven methods, and those are basically the protocols, which I have on the fourth point. You want to have a very rigid protocol for how do you acquire the image, and then how do you load the image and do the measurement so that we're all doing everything exactly the same way. And most of the vendors have good training courses for that, and they have folks that come in and help with that. But the key is having our sonographers actually, you know, be rigid with those standards. And it does work. If people that know me know I've been teaching this a long time, and everybody that uses a very strict kind of a military protocol as to how they acquire and analyze tend to become very, very tight for personal variability, and then over time as a team, lower variability. And this is what we really need in the HF patient. So in research or follow-up studies for key patients, I have several patients that I follow for many years. Generally, we always set it up so that I do that at person's echo, because we're really trying to reduce my personal subjectivity as well as other persons so we can get consistent data. And we actually have a case to show that talks about that. So basically 3D speaks volumes. Everything else speaks dimensions, it speaks assumptions, it speaks all kinds of things. But when you speak volumes, you can really treat a heart failure patient because there are so many things that cause it. And we have to always remember that as good as we are at 2D echo, at the end of the day, we're taking very thin slices of a very large mass of ventricle. And so you can say, oh, well, the anterior septal is moving very well, wall's moving well, but in truth, we're only covering a small piece of it when we have an entire segment that's actually affected. And if you have more complex diabetic disease or diagonals or, you know, things like this, people that have angina that's hard to manage, you may or may not be seeing that exact region in our traditional 2D view. So we need this stuff. We need the whole heart into the volume so that we can not only just look at the wall motion qualitatively, but then we can also, you know, analyze some of that and see what we see. I think using wall motion and displacement is helpful, but I think the strain imaging is going to really, really key in more and more on more specific regions of dysfunction or ischemia or, you know, things like that. So we'll see. But I mean, Dr. Nat Pandian at Tufts, who's now, I believe, out on the California coast with the Hogue Institute, they did a calculation where they took the thinness of a 2D slice and did the whole echo exam and determined that in a full 2D, looking at every of the normal views of the LV, we were only seeing 10% of the myocardium. That's with all the short axis and the long axis and the apical views, where with the 3D volume, we have 100%. So now we just have to get to an age where we can get better data sets with less heartbeats and higher frame rates. So these are some of the things we worry about. We're putting a lot of clips in at our center. We have a very robust MitraClip site. These are patients that we're going to evaluate before and after with LV volumes. We have people with this ischemic disease we're going to have to evaluate. We have these patients here that have these off-angle views that if you were to do a singular biplane, you're probably not going to get a very accurate volume on this person here with this little Barlow valve. And then, of course, people with MR can fool us badly because the LV is big and weak, the LA is very large, and so the color flow really is just completely useless for severity. So you have to look at, is it primary or secondary MR, and then what can we do to quantitate that, which tends to be more using PISA and things like that. So basically the history we've gone down is we started out simply looking at wall motion and volume displacement. Those were the early days. Then we started doing some things in desynchrony and SDI, Then we started looking at regional deformation shaping, severity. I think Phillips did some good work in this. Then we got into some derivative measures of length and you know, longitudinal strain and deformation within the myocardium as far as transmural. And now we're getting to 3D area strain or full 3D strain, which is really in the very early stages of being numbers that we would use rather than the derivatives that we currently use, which are circumferential strain, longitudinal strain, and twist and torsion. But as most of you know that are probably updating your carts or buying new carts, we are getting much higher temporal rates now, and that's going to have a big effect on how quickly we advance and use more and more specific 3D imaging for a lot of what we do. So we just want to be sure that in our reporting package, or regardless of how you all express your patient data, that we're getting these key things. We just want our volumes, our body surface area, and our heart rate. All these things are to give us determinants for the heart failure specialist to use to treat the patient. And so we can have a stroke volume index and cardiac output and cardiac index, very simple things to calculate with these basic numbers. Then from that, in the deeper section, which we talked about a minute ago, we're now looking at what can we do with 3D strain and area tracking. Can we look at 3D strains instead of having to do a little bit more subjective 2D strains? We're comparing those things. And then how important is twist and rotation? Is it really helpful? We know what it means and how it's related to contractility and myocardial disarray. We're not really sure, you know, how much we need to say in the reports at this point, because they all go together. So this is a good thing here. Basically, they say they review on this article that the authors discuss the differences of the currently available strain estimation and an overview of the current status of their validation. So I would highly recommend you read this article, and this will catch you up kind of where we're at with that. And that's a couple of 3 years old. So now let's talk about using the program technically. We want to use the CMRI standards. And then the standards of the CMRI is that we're going to include the mitral tenting area as we do here. We're going to include the papillary muscle and apparatus. We're going to include trabeculations that are within that. And that's where MRI, they're very spoiled. They get much better resolution, spatial resolution. They get smoother images, and they don't have to fight to see things as much as we do unless we're using contrast. This is what we need to be doing. But contrast in 3D is still evolving, and we will touch base on that. And one comment I would make, too, is that the apex, in general, this is actually a fairly abnormal heart. It's generally very thin. And if you look closely, you can see where this apex is actually pooching out. You can see here in the four-chamber view. So this patient clearly has something wrong going on in the inferior septal, anterior, and septal walls, because it's actually kind of moving the wrong way. So you can see that comparative there. But we want to use these standards. So when you do a 3D volume with the analysis package, you want to see an MRI picture in your head. I tell people to look at MRI pictures a lot, because ultimately the muscle is smooth, and within that muscle you have the trabeculations, the papillary apparatus, and other things, but we want to look strictly at the true endocardium, which is the hard line of where the muscle is. I won't go over this, but this is a protocol I put into a paper I wrote a few years ago. It was actually an RV paper, but this is really a very, very good table for people who want to be better at acquiring good 3D data sets, transthoracic. It really will work, I can assure you that. And you'll have my email if you have any questions or are having trouble. So we'll take the data set, we'll do the things in the table, we'll get a good picture. Sometimes the picture doesn't look that great. This is from a Toshiba card here that I did some research with. But the main thing is that you have all the elements within the data set. You'll be shocked at how well some of the software will track if you know what you're looking at and you know how to load the templates. And then we'll load that, and from that we can get all kinds of derivatives. We can get these polar maps with 3D displacement here, and they can see where some walls are contracting more robustly than some of the other walls. And you can see it would probably be here at the base and much lesser so here at the apex. We can get a parametric read out of that, and we can look at the time to peaks. We can look at the millimeters of excursion and the displacement. And then we can also get polar maps where, you can see where the base is contracting quite robustly and the apex up in the apical area is not quite so much, if not dyskinetic. I mean, generally that would be usually a left anterior descending type problem. This is a picture from my friends up at UMass that they looked at, where we can also generally see bundle branch block very easily. Where here you have a very heterogeneous waveforms. They're all peaking at the same time, have a nice bell curve, and then things get all spread out with bundle branch block. Again, this would be on strain imaging here, and you will notice if you've done a lot of this that if you have someone with, say, 150 millisecond delay, you would see it on M mode, and you would also see it on the 3D imaging. You can see easily see the divide between the interoceptal and the more lateral walls. Just another example where this is just a 2D cut plane, but you can get very good 3D modeling, and you can easily see where some of the wall abnormalities are. You get your volumes, you get your mass, and then you can again see where those are. So all these derivatives can be watched, monitored, tracked, put into a spreadsheet. It's just a matter of where you work and what you're doing with it. For most folks, it's just the volumes. Just another example here of how easy it is to see certain types of wall abnormalities. So let's just look at some cases. That's what we're really here for. And we'll start with electrophysiology. This is from an old case here. This is just really an example. We're not going to talk about systolic disynchrony because we're not really evaluating that as much as we used to. It's certainly a good thing to be looking at when they're doing things. Sometimes I still get a consult from an electrophysiologist to measure the disynchrony and do some other measurements on diastology and inflow when they're making a decision to upgrade a device and perhaps they're looking at a CRT. But by and large, it's become more simple. I think we know who we put CRT devices in and how to optimize them, and we don't do nearly as much evaluation. But at the end of the day, you can see a very nice, again, here's a large disarray of contraction from the bundle branch block. You can see how wide the QRS is here, and it's very disorganized, not very contractile, very large systolic disynchrony index. Same patient after the CRT, and this was literally, I think, the next day or 2 days later, the 3D data set, nice bell curve, everything's peaking, QRS is shorter, and the SDI is actually within normal limits. It would be great if they all did this. They don't, but it's very sensitive to these things, and it can be very a good confirmatory information when you're doing certain types of work on patients and you want to be sure that they're optimized. This is a presentation I did a couple of years ago, an abstract, where we took all the ways that we look at disynchrony and compared that to 3D strain, and within that, we would take a data set and look at the areas of most contractility. Any areas that had strain less than 8%, we excluded for wire placement. And then once we had that, we would put the wire through fluoro into the area of disynchrony that was most disynchronous and showed viable motion by at least 8% strain or more, which is technically -8, but I think everybody understands that. And then we looked at which groups post, this is retrospectively, were more concordant where the wire went and which ones were discordant. And then after that was done, I was actually more surprised than anyone looking at the data that it was so obvious how much better the patients with concordant wire placement to the area of most disynchrony with muscle viability were to the discordant ones because these are all very tight p-values. They were all actually less than this number, as I have noted here. And these people went from, you know, wall motion delays by MO from 264 to 100. Their SDIs were cut in half. Their end diastolic volumes went from 186 to 138. It just goes on and on. It was a tremendous little study for the number of patients, which is 28. It was amazing results. Another case here, this is a fellow I know well, it comes in and he does some type of work. He has a CRT in, but he doesn't want to keep it on. I don't remember the reason. I guess it doesn't matter. But they've been following him because he has a CRT in, you know, implanted, but he doesn't use it. And so we have to look at him off and on. And so they had recently decided to turn it on and see how it was going because they were concerned about leaving him off. So if you look at his pictures, you can see really it doesn't look that bad. There's contractility. You can kind of see the septal bounce here from the bundle branch block, but visually, you would send this person home and say, leave this thing alone. We looked at his diastology. This is after being on for 2 months. Really just abnormal relaxation. He doesn't have a lot of elevated left atrial pressures. His ED primes are normal. His pulmonary vein inflow is normal, so not a lot of concerns there. Of interest, because of his timing, he does have posterior activation before septal activation, which many times it tends to be the other way around. So he has kind of an inverse polarization of the heart, and he does have some level of disynchrony that would go with bundle branch block, which you can see here by criteria of usually 150 milliseconds. This is his 3D volume displacement. It really doesn't look that bad. This is, again, where it's spread out. And actually, you can see this is the earliest part of the phase here on the polar map. And so, again, it's showing that its earlier contractility is posterior, posterolateral, and late contractility is over here towards the inferior septal. So this matches the M mode perfectly. So, again, 3D can correlate very well with other measurements. And if you're sorting something out, it's really good to do all the measurements to see what's really going on with the patient. And again, you generally would be considered to have greater than 8% SDI to be clinically significant. So really, he's not, he's just kind of right on the borderline of being dysynchronous enough to where we'd expect a problem. So that means the CRT is doing its job. So we look at his volumes. Heart is not super big for its size. It's 144. And his index is not that bad. But his EF had been running 53 or 55. And we did notice his EF was down. And we also noted this right here. This kind of made our interest a little bit. So he has some type of cardiomyopathy. This is less than the longitudinal strain was before. This is low for circumferential. Circumferential, you generally would expect to see at least 23 or higher. So this kind of caught our attention here. And that made him a little bit more concerned about getting too aggressive about doing anything. Here's his longitudinal strain curves here, and again, they're good, but they're not that great. So basically, we didn't see a lot of difference clinically in how he felt, but his progressive decrease was a bit of a concern. The strains being below normal were a concern, so we definitely let him know that he needed to leave the device on. He wasn't really happy about it, but this is a way you can use 3D Echo and all your other tools to track people that look qualitatively pretty good, right? The first picture you saw, we might not have been too concerned about doing anything differently, or we may have turned it off. But so you really have to have all the tools in the box. This is also a very interesting article. I put in the video mostly for you to reference, but it's really worth reading about the shape of how the contractility of the ventricle affects the actual outcomes to CRT. Another case example here. You may have heard of a parachute device that goes into the ventricle that remodels it. I'm not going to go into that in a lot of detail, but I'll show you some things that we did. The patients were required to have STEMI of the LAD in the anterior septal segment. Generally, we were looking for people with apical akinesis, and we had to have some reasonable amount of function at the base and mid sections. So this is kind of a classic one here. You have a dead, you know, apex, some contractility in the base and the mid sections. In all three views, so this is kind of a perfect patient for this. And so let's talk about longitudinal strain before we look at the images. Is some are not as aware that when we look at global longitudinal strain, it's really not that complicated. We're taking the diastolic, end-diastolic, you know, frame, and the algorithm is literally measuring this distance as a curved distance, as if you took a string and just pulled it closer together with your fingers. And then in insistently, we're measuring the same distance and length, and it's the differences in the length that become the amount of global longitudinal strain. So this is not really specific per se to, you know, regional function or, you know, contractility. It's all about global contractility because it's taking in the twist, the torsion, the motion of the base and the apex towards each other with that twisting, and what the differences in length are. And because it's easy to basically calculate and easy to perform, it's become a very good number to put in on certain patients. And so here we'll look at the longitudinal strain in 2D, and I have the vectors turned on. The vectors are helpful because they don't tell you anything, but they give you a little bit of an idea of how good the timing of the heart is, because they'll be kind of out of sync if they're dysynchronous, and then really which ones are really coming in and moving, because just looking at all the pixels, you can see here there's very little going on. And of note, if you'll notice, he has a very global issue here, even with the infarction. This is a minus 10, minus 9 in the three chamber, and 10. So basically we have a longitudinal strain of 10. And this is isolating those vectors so you can kind of see how that looks. And here's the three chamber. And the four chamber. And you can see again, see how little strain there is in the apex, very little here. It's right on the mark of what we saw or would have qualitatively looked at on the 2D images, but now we have data underneath that that we can use. And we're taking all of this into 3D imaging. Not exclusively, but it's coming. And again, you can get a roadmap. The average strain was 10, as I said. We did the person on TOMTEC, a completely different program. This is the LVA program. We got our volumes. We got our forward stroke volume. Got an EF of 35%, which sounds about right. I think we all eyeballed that one good, right? But look here, identical. And so I have not published it. I'm sure other folks are doing the same thing. But I'm seeing a very good correlation with a quality 3D data set of my strain values in 3D to the higher frame rate, higher temporal rate, 2D. And I dream of the day of just taking a single high frame rate 3D data set and we're done, because we get an awful lot from this data set. We're twist, our torsion, everything we need. And again, here's looking at the same patient here, and we can see where the strains are more robust or less robust. And here's another one I'm not going to go into detail on, but they also looked again against about left ventricular twist and what the relationships were there with the rotation and the twist in groups of healthy volunteers to get normal values. So now let's get into the applications for the heart failure patient. That's the technical aspect. One of the things we want to look at on those in particular are the index. The volume is important, but the index is important because generally as a patient becomes more and more, has more and more regurgitation, they have more, you know, stealing from the systemic because you have more and more going into the ventricle, and they have to try to balance that battle with the afterload reducers to keep the blood moving through the heart and all of it all sucking back. So they try to bury more volume into the body, into the systemic peripheral system. After a while, that usually does not work if the valve gets worse. It depends on what's driving the regurgitation, because the root dilates, you know how this works. And so we really have to have these numbers, because AR can be extraordinarily hard to evaluate by echo unless they have so much that it's not a big decision. It's severe or moderate to severe. But sometimes these moderate people, just like mitral disease, they can be very difficult to measure an echo. It's hard to look at the color flow. It's hard to get a real sense sometimes of how much there is. So if we know what the end-diastolic volume is and the index of that and the EF, then we have some hard numbers that we know from STS data that we need to watch these people more closely. And then we want to look at the pressure gradient, of course, going across the valve, because it gets higher as the regurgitation is worse. We want to look at forward stroke volume, because that will become higher. We want to look at global longitudinal strain, because the strain where the heart may contract the same and look the same, the strain will become slowly decreasing because of the wall pressure on the left ventricle as it becomes more tension from the AR and from the pressure loading. And then, of course, the diastology always speaks to that. Here's a really good article, another reference that won't go into big detail, but here it is for you to look it up when you can watch the video later. But basically, results are that GLS was significantly lower in patients with AR before surgery compared with healthy control. So these folks are going to get surgery anyway. This is strictly a data analysis. While the global circumferential strain and ejection fraction did not differ, and the difference between the patients and controls were evident for the global longitudinal strain. So it's a very good number that we can get, and we can get all of that from a 3D data set. So basically, that's what they found, is that you need to look at longitudinal volume, you need to look at your volumes, volume loading, and longitudinal strain in patients with AR. And you really should do it at all levels, even if it's mild, so that you have a good serial, you know, evaluation of these patients as they progress. Hopefully they won't. So here's a fella I did some echoes on, and he was getting more lightheaded when he stood up, postural lightheadedness, near syncope a couple of times. He was getting more bradycardia, which is actually a sign of increased pressure on the aortic root from the vagus system. So here's his 2D echo on the front end. You know, this is a young guy that's active, so, you know, athletic people tend to have larger hearts, so, you know, you would look at it and go, not so bad, maybe a little bit, you know, pooched out here, but really I wouldn't think much of this. I did the strain values, though, and this really surprised me. I mean, if you look at the previous picture, this is just a long axis turned sideways. Look at the strain. That really, really surprised me. So this is a perfect example of somebody that clearly demonstrates, you know, good contractility, but has pressure. And if you look really closely, you can see negative strain here in the apical lateral and negative strain in the mid lateral, and how these are lower. And what's happening is the volume loading is discretely affecting the loading conditions and probably pulling on that papillary muscle. And it's just not quite coming in. And that's just so hard to see without this type of analysis. So we did the 3D on it. I don't think he's got bundle branch block, do you? Peaks are pretty, you know, heterogeneous. It looks pretty good. And you can see the differences here in the contractility as far as distance. So here we did circumferential strain. Doesn't look too bad here, to be honest. Looks like it's contracting pretty well. We looked at the GLS in 3D on a different program. And do you see what the number is? The number is exactly the same longitudinal strain number I had from the longitudinal strain pictures that were 2D in QLab. So again, I'm becoming more and more in the camp that the training and the specific to the protocol and the image settings and the how well the sonographers are using the programs is going to have a lot more to do with some of the agreement than vendor. I'm just, because 3D does not have as tight of scan line, does not have as much spatial resolution because of the way X arrays work, but yet it seems to have good specificity in many cases that I've done. So again, we looked at different software, and I'm just pointing this out, negative 10 over here, negative 10 over here. So in 3D strain and volumes, your EDV could be normal. You could may have a mild increase in your end systolic volume, which of course would just be a change in EF. You want to look for EF less than 50%. That's always a cutoff for people that have significant AR moderate or greater and are clinically symptomatic. This is concerning, as we already said. His clinical symptoms were not that bad, so they'll probably just follow this fellow up. So here's some technical perspectives. Here's a case in transplantation. As we know, transplant patient often has abnormal septal motion, and part of that is the way the heart ties in without a pericardial sac, and also from the way that's tied in up high where they do the anastomosis of the atria. So here we do our volumes here. End diastolic volume is around 84. I think I actually did both planes, but it just shows this one. So we're going to try transthoracic. That was just a single TEE shot. It looks like a very reasonable picture to do it with. So we used our things like my offline image view here that I used for the volume. So yeah, looks like here we got we don't have the biplane written on here, but so 129, 99, so an average around 110, 115 EDV, and looks like we've got an EF of around 47. We put it into the TOMTEC program, LVA, and we're going to demonstrate how we can easily line these up into the true apex in the middle of the mitral annulus, and this is going to put those planes in there and correct that. And here we've got an EDV of 144, so this is a difference between 2D, the angulation, and the planar alignment you get. This is a big deal because it's going to affect, for one thing, the EF is now 51, but more importantly, in this case, it affected the stroke volumes much higher than I got the other way. But again, the 3D tracking is 9%. So we have a concern there with this transplant heart, but this is probably a lot to do with the septal motion of the transplanted heart. And again, here's my personal correlation between the two programs are very good, same EF and the same global longitudinal strain. Just another example here. As we'll see in the program, there's lots of choices. Here's two operators, one of my sonographer trainees and myself, doing some pictures and this analysis. This patient clearly has some issues, one being not such great pictures, but there's obviously akinesis here. The base does not look like it's doing too bad, a little thin here, but mostly up here in the LAD portion probably. So we'll look at the short axis here. Again, kind of iffy images, not the best. This is probably a little foreshortened and off angle. You can tell by the trabeculation. But again, you see this abnormality here in the septal region. So we put some contrast in, because that's what you're supposed to do. And immediately we elucidate more complex morphology up here. This is the RV apex here with a moderator band, but you can see a very complex, discrete, thin scarred infarction and in kind of a wider, flatter area, and then a more contractile base and mid region. So wasn't really what it looked like by 2D, which is why we use contrast. So we did a, I believe she did this. This is her biplane imaging here. I think she did a pretty good job. I believe I was with her when she actually did the tracking. You can see how she excluded papillaries, went under the mitral valve, went through the trabeculations where the contrast edge of the feather is, and did a really nice job tracing around this little aneurysm here. And then I loaded this into 3D LVA, and this is a demonstration that I'm actually getting very, very good results using contrast and 3D full volume data sets. Part of that, I think, is because the TOMTEC system takes orders, which I like a lot. It does its automatic tracing, but then you can adjust that, and when you adjust it, it takes orders very well, and it's a good soldier. So the contrast, as much as anything, probably is not helping the automatic tracking, but it's helping me be sure I put the templates in the right spot at end diastole and systole. So, and then when I run the analysis is behaving not only to the tracking for the global tracking, but it's also behaving well because I gave it really good instructions. I'm very excited about this. I think all of us are excited about the concept of using contrast in high frame rate 3D volumes and getting good data. So it's pretty interesting. So again, here's just a visual image of that where I've rendered it. Here at the apex, I was looking at this little aneurysm. You can see where it's kind of pooching out in systole here and getting larger. This is just a smoothing color algorithm, but you can get really good wall motion images. This is the 3D strain. This is just showing where you have very little motion up here in the anteroseptal part of the base, and that's down where the aortic valve is, so that could have been my tracking a little bit. And you can see here, maybe I didn't catch the bottom of the tent there on the bottom of the volume. I have to look. But the average function was good. But again, you can see the bundle branch block. See that? You'll never miss that. After this, hopefully, you'll always notice that it's very easy to see in strain tracking. And then here, we loaded it back here. This is just displacement, same derivatives. So let's look at some of the things we look at as the close as far as the heart failure side. The hypertrophic myocardial disease, what we're looking for is people that generally start out with LVH, but they're going to have decreased preload and volume because it's thick, but it's not really enlarging yet. And generally, a lot of times, as we know, we see these in small females that have some type of genetic component. They just get this LVH, and they have hokum and things like that. And so along with that, we want to look at the diastolic function, left atrial enlargement, and especially look at the size of left ventricle. Is the left ventricle becoming overloaded or is it underloaded? And is there a secondary MR going on with that because of the fact that the LV is getting bigger? And then we want to continue to watch them in the 3D echoes with the same, hopefully, person, but if not, the same technique, which is 3D, so we can see there's incremental increases in volume overload and also the left atrium, which is common. They start having AFib and all those kind of things. And these kind of patients that, if you see in the report, they have class 3 to 4 heart failure, that you should have an algorithm in your center to always do 3D volumes at the minimum these people. If you're not going to do it on all your echoes, certainly these folks, it just doesn't make sense to not be doing a 3D echo. Because sometimes even they can get the data set and I'll actually go in with more expertise and do the analysis as an advanced sonographer. So it's not always about are they doing the work all the time, or perhaps I would just redo the work and check their work. So there's a lot of good reasons to do that because you always have that 3D data set historically as a record that you can go to and go back and look at. For chronic MR, in the early onset, generally you look more at the LA size, LA pressures. You certainly want to look at this though because you need to know this. If this patient progresses, you need to keep watching the LV volumes and the LA volumes because a lot of times the MR severity, if it's qualitative, isn't changing. So they'll say, oh, the MR was moderate last echo. The MR is moderate, last month. I did it again and it's still moderate. But are they looking at all these other things that go with that? Because I could show you cases all day of people who were slowly, insidiously getting larger left ventricle and larger left atriums, but they were just looking at the page that had the line, what the MR severity was. So if you're not comparing the other things that go with it, you can be fooled, and these patients are actually degrading, and you're having the same EF in the same MR, but you're not watching what you're really supposed to be paying attention to, honestly, is the remodeling of the ventricle and the left atrium before they get into AFib and all these other problems. So when you're getting up there, you really want to start looking for a big increase in LVEDV and MR, and especially forward stroke volume. In MR patients, you should always do a pulse wave stroke volume to compare that to your 3D volume, because when you compare them, you'll see there's a big difference between the 3D volume and the forward stroke volume, because a lot of the volume is going backwards into the mitral valve. For AR, same thing. I don't think we have to go over it a whole lot. You want to take volumes, look at changes in size and changes in strain. If it's 2D strain, that's great. Do your GLS, do all those things. For shunts, same thing. You need a good size volumes. We actually do LV and RV volumes here so we can compare the sizes of the ventricle. The size of the RV in some shunts, if they're large ASDs that are chronic or congenital, they can be problematic even after a repair. So you kind of need to know what the loading conditions are so they can be ready from a volume and inotrope side when they come off of a pump after you fix, say, a patient with a large ASD and a large right ventricle. Younger patients, you don't worry quite as much, but it's always a risk, and it's not something you go into without all the information. They probably get an MRI, I mean, but still. And QPQS, you can do volumetrically. We don't do it as much here that way, but you can certainly do it that way. And then, so for load reduction, what we're looking for is when the HF patients with ACEs and ARBs and diuretics and all those kind of things. I take Vasartan myself with HCT. You can track, you know, if there's remodeling, you can track if the heart is not as thick, because in LVA you can measure mass, and that's helpful. And 3D mass is by far better than Tycholt's from 2D measurement. And so we'll just continue to track our preload volumes, volume index, especially this one. The index for end-systolic volume is very tight to many devices, excuse me, like pre-LVAD, pre-transplant, and the global stroke volume and forward stroke volume, which is what I mentioned just shortly. So this is the finish of this slide. You should have this on the video, and there's my email there, rick.meese@comcast.net. I get a lot of really nice emails. I get notes on the ASC forum if you're on there, but always happy to help, whether it's technical tips on taking pictures or, you know, anything I can help people with, I'll be happy to do that anytime that I can. And so from that, I'm going to try to get out of this. And so I have a data set loaded here in LVA. Looks like several beats of something here, but this is a bad data set. So I want anybody that's been in any of my courses knows that I don't fool around with a bunch of perfect young patients with great data sets. I mean, when they come to my course, they know that we're going to be looking at what they see every day at work, which is a data set not too far from this. It's a little grainy. You can kind of sort of see that, you know, what's going on. It's not that clear, you know. But that's what we live with, right? So I will just try to adjust the brightness and see if there's anything that helps us see the edges of the images better. We can mess with the contrast. So sometimes I'll end up increasing contrast, increasing brightness a little bit, and you just have to find a happy medium and go with it. And, you know, if what you get works, then great. If it doesn't, then you learn something. There's going to be a little area here we may not see as well, but remember, these are 2D thin cut planes of a 3D data set. So the tracking is going to see a lot more than what you see here. It's going to be looking at the whole thing. So you can get a little too hung up on quality until you've actually run it and see how it looks. So we can take this up in the mid ventricle, moving the data, and look at the wall motion. I can kind of scan through the whole data set. You can see the apex moving here, and then you can see kind of the midsection. And so, you know, it's not a great data set. It just isn't. It doesn't have contrast, but I'm going to give it a shot, okay? I hope nobody minds that. So we will just hit a revision. I've got my mitral here in the middle of the annulus in all three views. I've checked to be sure I have a three-chamber where it says three-chamber. And so we'll do our revision. And you can see even now, and it's on a smaller plane with more pixels on the screen, you can see the edges a little bit better. So now we have a pop of a revision, and if we take our data set here and look and turn in the different views, it's pretty obvious that we're discounting the apex a little bit, right? There's a little bit of fuzz. It just didn't really see that. And this is kind of confirmed. So we can just make this bigger. We'll take the apex and just pull it up where it should be. And then we get the feedback over here on this part of the image. I can actually turn this down a little bit so you can see it better. You can see the green better. And this looks a little generous, right? So we'll pull this in here. We'll make sure we have this all the way to the mitral annulus. This is really important because all that longitudinal motion happens from the annulus upwards. And if your data set is too high up here, you're going to miss a lot of volume and function because you need to get all of the function that happens down to the annulus here and then fill in the holes where you think there's some spatial, you know, divide between the template and the tracking, and kind of go with that. And then I'll go then to the two chamber, and this doesn't look quite right. It's not too bad. And I'll fill this in and pull it out here. I'll make sure I'm down into the tenth. This actually did a pretty good job. And we'll pull this out here. I'll give it a shot. This is a tougher one. I'm looking at the edges of the trabeculation, and I know that the template goes inside of that because that's all those are. And then we'll go here. I'll take a look at the long axis. And of course, here you can see how they have a divide for the aortic valve there, so that you're taking in the volume of that left ventricular outflow tract. There's a lot of debate about that I know Dr. Lang worked on addressing in some of the newer packages for just 3D imaging. So that's reasonable because I know this is trabeculation here. This seems to be fairly good. And so we'll go back here. I don't do a lot in the short axis unless there's something very grossly wrong, because you're really setting this when you do these three walls. It's going to give the widths and dimensions. So if it's reasonable, I don't go nuts with the short axis unless I really see something I don't like. So we'll do some tracking. So what did you think the EF was? You know, it's not that good. I'd say most people would eyeball that and call it probably 25 to 30%. And guess what? I just threw that out there. I've never done this data set. I pulled this out of an old archive. So I eyeballed it just right. It's 28.7. It's between 25 and 30. Looks pretty big, 205. So we can see our data sets here in motion. We can see the template within the 3D data set, and we can confirm that it looks like it's within, reasonably within the walls that we see well, and pretty much within the walls we don't see well, you know, and you can see contractility. I'm not unhappy with this at all, quite frankly. This is moving well. It's tracking the annular motion. The apex all looks pretty good. And if I wanted to say, let's say it's not coming in quite as far in systole here, then what you do is you go to your systolic frame and pull this in a hair and see there. I think I'm going to pull it back out because I don't really believe it. This one really doesn't need much editing, but that's what you do when you edit these. You simply pull the template in. You can see what I did at the bottom here, and you'll pull it into the point where you think it's actually contracting into that area. Okay, so if we're happy, we'll hit analysis. We'll get our butyl or beutel, which means bag in German. And we get our volumes, we get our forward stroke volume. We could compare that to his pulse stroke volume if he had a lot of MR. EF after analysis is slightly higher. It's more at 30, 31, but we still guessed it right. GLS is 10, low, which makes perfect sense looking at this heart. Their circumferential strain is low, makes perfect sense with this heart. So what happens is when you get good at this, everything makes sense. Usually they all fit. And it gives you a larger algorithm to work with to analyze the patient. And then you can isolate your longitudinal strain and look at your peak strains here like this. And you can compare areas. Look how tight the bell curve. This is a big heart. It's a weak heart. It has abnormal longitudinal strain. But look how heterogeneous it is. This is not a bundle branch heart. I mean, this is really tight contraction. Now, some would argue that we don't have enough spatial resolution or temporal resolution, and therefore this is smooth because we don't have the sensitivity. I would not argue with that. I think I would on this particular patient, but that's why the higher frame rates that we're now getting with 3D data sets is going to play a very large role moving forward, 2017 forward, because it's all happening pretty much from all the vendors. So we have all these things. We can look at displacement. We can look at the twist. I doubt this is twisting a whole lot. Yeah, see, it's 0.5 and 2. We're usually looking more like 8 and 15 or 8 and 12, so that's probably not a whole lot going on there. So we have all the derivatives, circumferential, all those things. And what's even more cool is you can actually export this stuff here into all of this, into a text file, and you can load those into spreadsheets. So if you're going to do research, if you're going to track, say, the same patient for over time, you could literally track that patient in an Excel spreadsheet. It's a phenomenal tool. We've used this stuff so much. We'll never, ever have enough thanks for Berthold and the TOMTEC team in the studies they've helped me with. It's, you know, I wouldn't have done it without them. That's them. Okay. So quickly, I'm not going to go into much detail on the technical aspects. We're pretty much done, but I want to quickly load a TEE data set. There's a lot of anesthesiologists that are seeing more and more 3D. They realize that knowing the volumes on certain patients can be extremely helpful. And we'll just show the mild nuances. There's really not a lot of difference, to be honest. You just kind of load it the same way in LV analysis. And it's upside down. This program I have here, for some reason, doesn't always behave, but they have a modality you can use that you can see now, because it's TE and upside down, that the apex is still at the top because it doesn't know it's a transthoracic data set. Generally, I would be able to hit this. I've noticed lately this is not working. But really, all you have to do is just simply put the apex at the apex. I'm just swinging this around, and it immediately turns it. So it's really not like it's, I don't care, to be honest. It's easy. And you notice on the TE data set, you see more differences in the apex, because now we're looking from the apex, and we see shadowing. I mean, we're looking from the atrium, so we see the shadowing from the MAC here. And so TE data sets aren't always that great. And so from a acquiring perspective, I highly recommend you use lower transducer frequency, 2.5 or 3, which is usually like a penetrate mode, because it really cleans a lot of this stuff out of there when you're using it. And so here we want a kind of a 3-chamber, and so I can pull this down into the aortic valve so I can see it. And so I've got this plane down here, and there's the aortic valve there, so I'll just move this over there. And now I've got what I need, 3-chamber, 4-chamber, 2-chamber, right? So we'll do a revision. So basically, a TE data set, we get great data sets. If you're in the OR, you just turn off the ventilator, because then you don't have to worry about stitching. You can get a nice 4-beat data set, and you know, you're not fighting to get a good image. And then we'll just run our templates here, set them up. You usually get a really nice crisp endocardium on TE data sets. And this really, look how nice that trace there. Wow, I almost hate to move it, but I'm going to move it a little bit down into the mitral valve so we have the whole annulus, right? So we track all of that. And we'll just run that. Let's kind of run right through this one. And let it do its thing. We can do our cross comparisons. And just to go back, if you want to go and do mass, you hit the mass button. If it's concentric, you'll simply load this in there and make all of these pretty much the same width here and here. I routinely do mass. I didn't get into it earlier because I just didn't want to elongate our session. And we'll say, we'll just kind of pretend those are pretty good. And then you simply run it.
Hey, Rick, I don't want to interrupt you just for a moment. I'm not seeing any of the TEE data that you're talking about at this point. We still see the analysis for the transthoracic.
That's interesting. I haven't hit anything. You want me to try? Let me try here.
It could, no, possibly I'm still presenting. It could possibly be just on my end as well.
I don't know, but I mean, we don't really have to do this section. I would say to abort if you can't see it, and let's just go to questions and answers. That's what I would say.
Certainly.
There's no point in working out a technical issue because I'm technically done. So
perfect.
Let's do that. Yep. Let's do that. So I'll just load this here and take any questions.